Hi, Brian.
Morning, John. You can get rid of the mask now.
Thank you.
I guess I should mention that we're all wearing masks at all times, except when we're on camera, obviously. So, okay. So today we're going to talk about the GM-2-5AX, and this is a two-axis spindle head machine.
Yeah, so essentially the spindle is mounted on the fifth axis, which is B, and it tilts in an uncle, and then that's all mounted on C, which rotates around the Z axis.
Right. Okay. Let's talk travel real quick, because as you can see, this is a really big machine. We've actually got 87.5 inches of Y travel and 145 inches of X travel.
Yes. Now the table is 144 in X and 72 in Y. That's just inside of the posts here.
But we
do have 87.5 inches of Y axis travel. So that allows you to get your RAM off the end of the table and tilt over to 90 degrees to come down and have a little more extra room to machine from
right.
the sides.
So when your tool's over 90, you've got plenty of room to get to all sides of the part.
Yeah, yeah. And the rotary axes are the C axis, which rotates about Z, is plus or minus 245. So you would have to wind up and then unwind. You could do
come
a full 360 and more. Plus or minus 245 on C, plus or minus 120 on the B.
Okay, so one thing we really want to point out on this machine and the VR8, we'll talk about it again, is if you're interested in this machine, you really want to go on HaasCNC.com, go to the GM-2-5AX page, and look at the machine layout drawing. It's more important than ever on these five-axis machines to look at the work envelope, and John,
yeah.
I'll let you explain why.
Because the length of the tool holder and the length of your cutting tool, when that head rotates over 90 degrees, that now narrows your work envelope,
right?
So even though we have, 87.5 inches of Y-axis travel, if you've got tool buildup, tool lengths 8 inch long, and you tilt that over and you need to machine from this side and rotate over and machine from this side, well, you've cut your work envelope down by the length of that
your
tool
available
times two.
Gets a lot
smaller. So you really have to have a good idea of how long your tool holders need to be and how long your cutting tools need to be for your job before you can really start figuring out exactly if this machine is big enough for your work envelope. And it's a pretty big machine, so you shouldn't have too much trouble. This does become an issue when we get over to the smaller VR 8, 9, and 11.
Right, and we'll cover that in a little bit here.
Yeah.
And we'll also get into more, we're gonna talk about some other things like some safe zones and things like that that are built into the software of this machine, and we'll get to that here in just a little bit. The table, we talked about the table. This is an aluminum table.
Yeah, aluminum table, and 1 inch thick, bolted down to the base of the machine and cut to be flat on the machine itself after it's assembled. But we have optional steel tables. There's a steel Blanchard ground top table that's drilled and tapped. We have an inch version that's drilled and tapped half 13 on 4 inch centers, so it's an entire grid pattern. And then the metric version of that table is drilled and tapped M12 on 100 millimeter centers.
Okay.
So you can get either or.
Similar pattern, just metric or inch.
Yeah.
Now one thing we're gonna do, we're not doing a cutting demo, of course, but we are gonna run the machine. John has a demo set up here.
Yeah, I'm gonna go ahead and get started. I've got my large remote jog handle here. So I'll hit cycle start on this. This demo part that we have is an actual mold for the carbon fiber monocoque of a wind tunnel model. So this is a half-scale wind tunnel model of a monocoque of a Formula One car. Shout out to our friends at Fiberworks Composites in North Carolina for supplying that for us. They cut this mold, this actual piece, on the prototype version of this GM2
the very first one in their shop,
and then were kind enough to send it to us.
Yep, we really appreciate that. So we did a couple of things for purposes of the video and for the demo. Normally, this machine would come with some vinyl curtains to keep the chips and coolant contained.
Yeah, they're 5 inch wide, 80 thousandths thick pieces of vinyl that are attached to a rod and hang across the front here, and another one across the back, and it keeps everything contained really nice. You just can't see what's going on inside the machine from a camera's point of view.
Make for a very bad video.
Yeah, make for a pretty lousy
and
video.
Also, you segued right into my next segment by stepping in front of that when it was moving.
Oh, yeah.
Sal, can you get in on here, please? Get on this bumper right here. So explain how these bumpers work, if you would.
Previous
please.
Versions of our routers and this particular machine used to have a light curtain. But any time that the machine was running, I could see that I'm in no danger. I wasn't allowed to step in here. Now I can because we have a physical bumper here.
Right.
So it's going to put the machine into a feed hold condition and stop the spindle if I run into this bumper here, if this touches anything.
Right. So let's talk about the machine itself. The spindle, which we see running, is a 20,000 RPM spindle.
Yeah, fantastic 20,000 RPM spindle. It's a 16 horsepower peak and 13.4 horsepower continuous. It's really terrific for trimming composite structures, doing finishing work on 3D surfaces, hole making for sure.
Right. This is not a machine or a spindle built for heavy material removal.
Yeah, yeah. It's not the same spindle combination that we put in our VFs. It's a 30 horsepower inline. It is right. Not that, but certainly capable of what it's designed for.
Yep.
It's an integral spindle design. The motor is directly coupled to the spindle, and it's really, really fast, getting up to full speed and back down to zero. So spindle acceleration, deceleration, very, very quick. It's grease pack lubrication. So if you're machining a material that can't get contaminated with oil,
wood
exactly. So it's very good for that. And the spindle is liquid cooled. So there's a spindle cooler, spindle chiller that's mounted up here on the back, and it takes antifreeze, very similar
just
to what
like
you're using in your car, yeah.
Okay, some other standard features. It's got a 30 pocket tool changer, standard. It comes standard with probing, which is incredibly important on any 5-axis machine.
For sure. And the other thing it comes with is chip augers. Now, it doesn't come standard with a coolant kit. You can get a coolant kit, a tank, and pumps, but we do provide the auger. So if you're machining a material, wood or any other material, you can sweep the material off of the table down into the augers and then use the chip chutes for chip evacuation. Really, really nice setup.
Okay. And now there's some unique features software-wise. So that's the mechanical part of the machine.
Yeah.
There's some really unique features software-wise that you really wanted to talk about. And one of them especially is jogging this machine in certain modes.
Yeah. So we do have vector jog mode, which allows you to, when the spindle, when B and or C are not zero, you can press V and then J on the...
For vector jog.
On the keyboard for vector jog, and then the handle jog button, and now you'll be able to jog. I'm gonna feed hold it right there.
Okay.
I'm gonna reset my program. Frank, if you can bring up the screen monitor there. So I'm gonna press the key V and then J, and now hand jog. And you can see that I've gotten into hand jog mode because the position screens, the X, Y, and Z positions are highlighted. Now I just grab the handle wheel and back away from my part, and you'll see that we're jogging in, actually in this case, two axes because C was at zero, but B is tilted, and so we're jogging in the Y and the Z.
John, can you do that again so we make sure Sal gets that on camera? Can you
vector jogging.
Vector jog one more time, make sure he gets it?
Yeah, absolutely. So here I'm jogging along the vector of the tool, in towards the part and away from the part. This is super important. If you're drilling a hole and you hear that awful crunching noise of your drill breaking and you have to hit emergency stop, this is how you're gonna get that drill back out of your angled hole.
Or if the power goes out.
If the power goes out, exactly. Same thing, you go into recovery and then vector jog out.
Okay, cool. Cool feature.
Great feature for the 5-axis machine. Also, we have dynamic work offsets and tool center point control, standard feature in this machine. We'll talk a little bit more about that. Also, MRZP. So we have a special VPS template for finding the machine rotary zero point, MRZP. If you can get a shot over here, there's a tooling ball mounted to the table. So we probe that tooling ball in a couple of different positions and then store the values in settings, and essentially what that does is tell the machine where the location of the center points of the rotary axes are inside of the machine envelope. We store those MRZP settings. The things that are really key for a five-axis machine like this with the tilting head is the location of the center of C-axis rotation, the whole thing, and the center of spindle rotation, right? Those are mechanically assembled, and so there's gonna be some error, but for this machine to be accurate, there can be no error. So right. We measure that difference and compensate for it all the time. When you're jogging, when you're in cycle, it's always being compensated. The other piece of key information is what we call the pivot length of the machine, and that's from the center of B-axis rotation here to the face of the spindle. So once we know that and establish that with the MRZP, we use that pivot length and add the tool length offset to the tool, and now the machine knows exactly where the tip of that tool is all the time when I'm jogging, when I'm running a program.
Okay, and all of that also becomes important for another feature that's built into this machine, and we call it safe zones, right?
Safe zones. So safe zones are essentially a set of travel limits that are built around permanent elements of the machine. We have travel limits set up for the table. We have travel limits set up for the tool changer and the tool changer arm. These are safe zone limits, really. We have another set for the entire spindle head. And on this machine, since we have these columns on the sides that create the bridge and are part of the gantry, we also have zones that define exactly where those are. Now, as those things move through the machine space and the rotaries tilt, the machine is keeping track of where everything is and will not let you run a tool into the tool changer, for example. Right. If you were to come straight up with the B-axis rotated 90, moved over to the tool changer, and then tried to whip C around, it wouldn't let you do that. If you had programmed it, if it happens in a G-code program, you're gonna get an alarm, possible collision detected. And if you're in jog mode, it'll just stop jogging. You'll get to the end of the travel.
And actually, let's go ahead and show that. So,
okay.
What John's explaining here is when you've got your tool straight down like a traditional VMC, you're limited in how far you can travel. So jog that down in Z if you
would. So I'm jogging straight down in Z with B and C at zero. And you can see I'm gonna get down close to this table.
Okay.
And the safe zone prevents me from running that tool into the table. Now the cool thing here is I'm just gonna back up about an inch. I am gonna select the C-axis, rotate this around here, and then B. I'm gonna get my B up at 90 or so. And now you'll see that
now
I'm allowed
we'll
to go much
again.
Farther down in Z.
And again, the machine knows where the spindle is, the spindle head, and you're limited, you're jogging effectively stopped right there.
Yeah, exactly.
So, okay, so that's why the MRZP is so important. Other than just knowing where the center points are, it also
yeah.
knows where the tip of the tool is and factors that in depending on what angle the
yeah.
rotary axes are at.
Now, there's two different VPS templates in the control. There's one to set the MRZP, and essentially the spindle probe touches off the tooling ball, rolls over to the side, touches it off, and says, okay, now I know where the rotaries are. There's another VPS template that you need to run when the machine is first set up in your shop, and that's to calibrate the safe zones. So essentially, it's doing a very, very similar thing. It's probing that tooling ball because the tapped hole location in the table for that tooling ball is in a specific location.
Right.
The software in the machine knows where it is. So once we probe that ball, then it calibrates the actual travel limits of the safe zones in regard to, relative to that ball.
Relative to that,
and
right.
then those numbers are stored in the control. And so that process is two different processes, basically very, very similar thing, but it needs to be done twice. And we have VPS templates that make it super easy for the operator or the service technician who's setting up the machine to,
right.
to do that at installation and periodically through the machine's life.
Okay. Great. Do we miss anything?
Let's see.
Now, one of the things we're going to talk about that both machines have is something called planar jogging, but
oh.
I think the VR8 is better suited to show.
Yeah, we're
going to
talk about planar jogging on the VR8. I did want to mention a couple more things about safe zones. So the safe zones are around permanent elements of the machine, but there are elements that are not permanent. These splash guards are not part of the safe zone. So you could definitely run this tool. If I rotated that C around right there, I would run my tool in the splash guard. That is not protected. The other thing about the safe zones is safe zones are tool offset aware. So what we say in the manual, and essentially what that means is that it's reading the tool offset all the time and it knows where the tip of your tool is. But you gotta remember, if you have your tool offset set for tool number 4 and you take tool number 4 out and you go, oh, this next job's gonna run a different tool number 4 and here it is and it's longer.
The machine doesn't
know
that.
But you don't reset the offset, you're gonna be in big trouble if you're trying to jog that thing around, because it's gonna be reading the offset of the shorter tool. You've got a longer tool in, you can picture what's gonna happen. So your offsets need to be correct. It's a good practice every time you put a new tool into the machine, set its tool length offset right away. Don't wait.
I was going to say, that's good practice anyway.
Yeah, exactly.